All right, so since in our database class, we don't really have analysis of algorithms as a prerequisite, but the topic of indexes in our textbook kind of makes the assumption you know algorithms and you know, data structures pretty well. So this is kind of like not a supplementary lecture, but kind of what would be a prerequisite and a data structures and analysis of algorithms prerequisite for database students. All right, so. So again, this is mostly stuff you might see in an analysis of algorithms class or data structures class. But if we wanted to write computer programs that use graphs and solve problems based on graphs, and I'm sure you've done this like when you use your GPS in your car, you're at one location, you're trying to get to another location. There are many ways to get there, and you want to find the quickest way to get there, so use your GPS. So the GPS has to turn it into, you know, here's where you are and here's where you're trying to go, and there's many ways to get there and which is the quickest way to get there. So it's a popular topic in algorithms is to do graph algorithms. So what we'd like to do is we would like to take a graph like this or a graph like this and somehow record it into computer memory. So there's many ways to do it, and one way might be to have all of the nodes, the vertices or the cities, have a numerical value and have a two-dimensional array. And then just put a number one there in that box to say that they're connected. So we're saying that city number one is connected to city number two. We put a one there. And we're basically saying each city is not connected to itself. So usually popular put ones along the diagonal. And so we could say, you know, in this case, city number four is connected to one, two, and three. And in this case, we're also repeating the data because over here we're saying city number four is connected to one, two, and three. Okay. So city number four and city number one are connected. So one means connected, zero means they're not connected. So if you think about it along this diagonal, we're actually repeating all the data that's up here being repeated down here. We could also have graphs that have orientation. They have a direction to them. So we could have three different vertices. And in this case, one is connected to two, and two is connected to one. In this case, two is connected to three, but three is not connected to two. And for a driving app, this might be like a one-way street. You could go from here to here, but you can't come back. You have to find another. And in that case, we're now using up the whole two-dimensional array. So we're saying one is connected to two, and two is connected to one. But we're saying that two is connected to three. So it looks like you're going from here to here. The cities here is where you're going from, and the cities along here is where you're going to. So two is connected to three. Okay, but three is not connected to two. Right, so just two different ways of recording this picture in computer memory. So virtually means from the point of view of our mind, this is what you see, but this is what the computer actually records. So if you want to start running algorithms on this graph, you actually run your algorithms on this data. Then the idea, we could also include how much distance there is from one node to another. So this could be kind of a networking problem where all of these nodes are connected to each other, but maybe it takes several hops to get from one place to another. So for example, node number one and node number two have one hop between them. And again, this has no orientation, so we're repeating all the information on the diagonals being duplicated. But to get from two to, let's say, node number seven, what's the shortest way to get there? It might be one, two, three. It might have four hops. So to get from 7 to 2 takes 4 hops. And again, we're repeating all the data, so we have 4 over here. To get from 2 to 7 is 4 hops. We could also, if each of these arcs had a certain value to them, how much it costs to travel, we could record that into this graph too. So it doesn't have to be just zeros and ones. It could also include distance, or how much time it is. So there could be a traffic jam between here and here, and that makes this number go up higher. Might be how much time it takes to get from this point to this point. So again, we're running the algorithms on this data,
but virtually what we're doing is on the graph.
Another way to represent a graph, you might think this is overhead that doesn't make a lot of sense, but this will actually make sense a little bit later on. If we have a bunch of vertices, we number them, and then we make a series of linked lists. So we create an array of all the vertices, and then for every vertice, we make a linked list of all the cities it is connected to. So we're basically saying that city number one, or vertex number one, connects to 2, 3, and 4. So we say, all right, it's connected to 2. And then now this arrow, this is the address of the next piece of storage. It says we're connected to 3, which takes us to the next one. We're connected to 4. So does this seem like a lot of overhead that we could do this a lot? This would be a lot quicker to just fill this in with zeros and ones as opposed to making this collection of linked lists. Does one seem better than the other?
Yeah, maybe the previous one is better.
Yeah, the previous one, intuitively, it's very easy to do. You just create a two-dimensional arrays and you put checks wherever they connect. What we might learn is that, can you see any reason to have, so here's kind of a hint at the question. For every vertex, I am recording yes or no if it's connected to every other vertex. So if it is connected, I have to record that. If it's not connected, I have to record that. So if I'm running an algorithm that says, give me a list of all the vertices that one is connected to, I'm going to have to read through all of these looking for ones, whether there's a zero or a one. So if there were a very, very large number of them, so let's say, for example, we're at the intersection right outside the building here. That intersection can only connect to maybe 4 other intersections in the whole country, right? And then from there, I connect to another one. So I might be adjacent to only 4 other intersections. If I had to look through every intersection in the whole country, there'd be a lot of zeros just saying I'm not connected to. It'd be nice if I had just a list of what I'm connected to so I could decide which of those paths to take, right? So it could be advantageous. Here we're just recording what we're connected to. We're not recording what we are connected to plus what we're not connected to. So it might be advantageous. If I want to just know what am I connected to, I can just look at this little list and I'm done. But anyway, just for now, there's two different ways we could do this. Okay, so now I want to focus on a linked list. What is a linked list? And Java is a pretty popular language. So how can we write code that says, here's where my list starts, and it refers to an element in my list, and my element is a 2, and then I have a reference to another element, contains a 3 plus a reference to another element, and the last one has no further references. So in Java, what we would do is we would create a class called a list node or a city or whatever you want to call it, and we'd have some data, the number that refers to the city, and then we'd have a reference to the next city. We'll call it next, meaning the one after the one we're currently looking at. And then when we go to create the list, we can fill in the data. We have the constructor bring in the data plus a pointer to the next node. So we have methods that can link them together. And then if you want to say, if I'm at a current node and I say, what is my next node, I can have a get next and it will return the reference to the next field. So we can make a linked list. And then if you want to create the initial list, might call the init, a list might be initially have a head node pointing to the beginning of it, and we would fill in the head node with values, and then we can go and get the value and so on. Okay, so this would be just the code for creating this. Here's the head. The head is pointing to the first element of the list. Each element of the list has 2 fields to it, the data plus a reference to the next field. And we can dynamically add them as needed. Okay. Okay, so now let's compare an array versus a list. What are some advantages? When would you use one over the other? So linked lists are easy to do inserts and deletes into. So for example, if you had an array of 10 numbers and they were sorted and you wanted to put a number somewhere in the middle, what would you have to do? You'd have to take all the elements after the one you're sorting and copy them over by one to make room and then finally put the insert in. Whereas with a linked list, we could just insert into the middle of the list. So for example, if I wanted to insert these are in alphabetical order. If I wanted to insert a 2.5, what I could do is just go get a new piece of storage, put it here, have this pointer refer to the new one, put the new number in, and have the next field be pointed to this one. I don't have to move any of this data around. So inserts and deletes on a linked list are easier to do. Searching on an array is easy to do. If it's already sorted, you can just look in the middle of the array and based on that value decide to go left or right. Whereas with lists, you'd have to start at the head and walk your way through the list, searching for something. Okay. So another thing, like I say, I'm taking like tidbits from analysis of algorithms that are related to database systems. So we can have different types of graphs, and we can have a special type of a graph which is called a tree. And tree is really defined as any graph that has no circles in it. No cycles in it. So for example, you can't go from here to here and then back to work. So this is technically, even though it looks kind of like a Ferris wheel, this is technically a tree. This graph is also a tree. There's no cycles in it. And this actually kind of looks like a tree, right? The tree usually has a big bark and then, you know, branches on top. But what's more common in computer science is to draw this type of tree, which really looks like, it really looks like an upside down bush, right? This kind of looks like a tree. This looks like, if this was turned upside down, it would be like a bush, not a tree. But anyway, so it's popular to refer to this type of graph as a tree. Tree just means there's no cycles in the graph. Okay, so for example, we could have this, we're gonna call this an unbalanced binary search tree. So what is, let's define each of those terms. Binary means that each node has at most two nodes coming at it. Binary, so it has two nodes it's connected to. It's a tree, meaning there's no cycles anywhere. If I had an arc from here to here, I'd have a cycle. So the cycle would go like this, it would go in circles. So there's no circles in the graph. And unbalanced means if you were starting at the top of the tree, which they call the root, right? Because trees are planted in the ground and there's roots at the bottom of the tree. Like I said, this really isn't a tree. It's an upside down lime tree or a bush. So here's the root. And it's unbalanced because the distance of the lowest node here is 1, 2, 3, 4 hops, whereas the distance here it's only 2 hops. If they were all equal in distance, it would be a perfectly balanced tree. Trees could be balanced or unbalanced. So, and the reason this is a search tree is because of the ordering of all the elements. At every node, it has the property that whatever value is at this node, and it has two children, a left child and a right child, all the values to the left are less than this value. And all the values to the right are greater than this value. And that's true at every node. So if you went searching, let's say we wanted to search for the number 15, we would go to the root of the tree and look at this number. And if what we're looking for is less than 25, we would go to the left. If it was greater than 25, we would go to the right. So it's less than that, we'd go here. Now we compare 15 to 20, and we go left. Now we compare 15 to 10 and we go right, and we compare 15 to 12 and we go right and we find it. So we could use this tree for searching. If this was not ordered this way, we couldn't search. We'd have to search everything before we could find something. Okay, so you have binary meaning that has two children. We could have more children if we wanted to. Now what's the advantages and disadvantages of having more children? Suppose we wanted to have three children. instead of two. Suppose it was a trinary search tree instead of a binary search tree. If it had three children, then what we'd have to have is two values here. And we'd say if what we're searching for is less than both of them, we go to the left child. If it's between them, we go to the middle child. And if it's greater than both of them, we would go to the right child. So at every node, however many children you have one less value up here. If we have two children, we have one value. If we have three children, we have two values. If you have 100 children, you have to have 99 values. So you know which child to go to. Okay. What would be an advantage or disadvantage to having this data structure be balanced versus not balanced? Would that be an advantage or disadvantage to having a rule? So I guess one of the things you learn in your algorithms class is there's really no right answer to what data structure you should use. This is data, and it's all structured like a tree, so it's a data structure. Should you make the rule that it should be balanced or not? Really depends on what you're using it for. There is no right answer, but what would be an advantage to making the tree balanced versus not balanced? Let's see if I have it again. Well, you know what, let me go through the code for building a binary search tree. So this is again in Java. So we have a class called the binary search tree, and then we have a subclass in there called a node, which is a node on the tree. Each of the nodes will have a piece of data, and then it'll have a reference to a left child and a reference to a right child. And we'll have a constructor. If you want to create a node, you give me a value. I put the value into the data field, and I make the two children empty. That's when I'm creating a brand new node. If I want to later add a child, I would refer to left or right to refer to a new child. Okay, so if somebody then came along and said, I want to create a binary search tree, let's say they call it BST, they would say new, and they'd call a binary search tree, which would call the constructor, created. That's the Java code for it. And then if you wanted to actually do a search down the tree, looking for something, you call it, you give it a value that you're searching for, and you call it on the root node. And now the code just recursively keeps saying, if the root is null, that means we hit the bottom of the tree and we can't find what we're looking for, so we just return the root. And the root will come back as null, so there'll be no answer. If the field we're looking for matches the field at that node, we return that node, and that says we found the answer. If neither one of those is true, if the data is greater than the search value, we do a search on the left side and return that. Otherwise, we do a search on the right side. We just keep doing that till we hit the bottom. So that's the code for doing a search down a tree. So yeah, I wanted to go to the balance versus not balance slide. So suppose, for example, you started off with an empty tree and a new element gets added. The number one gets added to your tree. So you create a tree like that, just it has a one on it, a one with no children. Now you want to add another one. You want to add two. So you would look at the tree and you'd say, well, two's come after one, so I'll make it a right child. Okay, so now you have a tree like that. Now you want to add a three. You go to the root, you say three's come after ones, you go here, three's come after twos, you put the three here. Then you add a four, then you add a five, then you add a six. So this is a linear tree, and it's not balanced, right? We could store the same exact numbers in a more balanced tree. Like this. Now, what would be the advantages and disadvantages of leaving your tree this way versus turning it into a tree like this? In what case is this better, and in what case is this better? And this question comes up in databases. So one with it, one. So one thing, if I wanted to now insert a, let's say I wanted to insert a seven into this data structure, I would just read my way down to here and insert it here. If I wanted to insert it here and make the tree balanced, it would get a little bit more involved, right? I'd say, okay, a seven goes this way. Now a seven goes this way. I'd be looking to add it here. But I'd say to myself, now, I have a requirement, I want the tree to be balanced. So what I might then try to do is take the 5, the 6, and the 7, and somehow spin them, so it goes 5, 6, and 7, right? But that's gonna take more time. I'd have to write code that does that algorithm, that kind of looks at this tree and says, I'm trying to put in a 7, but I don't want to put it here, I want to take this child and push it up to the parent, now I have 2 here, I'll push this child to the left of this one, and that'll make it. So the difference between the two is an unbalanced tree is less time to alter it. If you want to add something or delete something, you just find where it goes and put it there. Or the thing you want to remove, you just remove it and have the grandchild connected now as a child. A balanced tree takes more time when you're altering the tree. Okay? So, looks like it's a disadvantage to have a rule that says it should be balanced, but what's the advantage to a balanced tree? The advantage to a balanced tree is if you go searching for something, you don't have to climb all the way to the bottom of the tree. Remember, when a search is being done, you look at a node, you read its value, you read what you're looking for, and if they don't match, you go left or go right. Each time you do that, it's another call to this method, this search method. You want to call this as infrequently as possible. So if I wanted to go looking for a 6, and I call the binary search, I would look here, and a second call, a third, fourth, fifth, 6 calls to get here. If I want to go looking for a 6 here, I call the 4. I call it on 5 and I call it on 6. It's 3 calls instead of 6 calls. So if you're searching for something, you find it faster if the tree was balanced. But the downside is every time you make an update, it takes longer because there's a lot more shuffling around. Okay. So let's just as an example, suppose you work for Facebook, which has over a billion users, and you go to log in, you type in your email and your password. They take your email, they look through their database looking for a matching email. If they go through it linearly, it's going to take a long time, because billions of them. So it might be good if there was some kind of an index, maybe some balanced tree that they look at your value and do a couple of hops and then they can find it very quickly. Okay, so what is an index? Not in computer science or not in the database, it's just an index. So if you opened up a book, you might have at the beginning of the book a table of contents. A table of contents is really an index. An index is just something that tells you where stuff is, if you wanted to jump to it very quickly. So this is one of the students' capstone project. But it's basically saying if you wanted to get to, you know, simple statement by the author, on page 5, you would just jump to page 5. Or like, now if you think about it, an index, a table of contents in a book, is really an index that takes you to the first page of a chapter, right? Let's say we had, you know, let's say you wanted to go to chapter 5, and you wanted to, in a book, you wanted to just read chapter 5. The table of contents tells you where chapter 5 starts, right? Wanted to read the whole chapter 5, what would you have to do? You'd have to jump to the beginning of chapter 5 and then read each page sequentially until you get to the end of chapter 5, right? The index takes you to the beginning and then you go along a linked list until you get to the end of the chapter. So a table of contents, a book has a table of contents, which is an index that tells you where something starts, and then because the book was printed with all the pages sequentially, really the entire book is a linked list if you think about it. So, a table of contents is an index to a linked list, and that's exactly what we're going to do in our database class. So, so now just back to just what is an index. It's a data structure used to find data, unstructured or structured data. So if you're going to look for something, you go through maybe a binary search tree, or it could have many children, not binary, and like we said, the index to a paperback book will tell you where a page starts, and then you go through each page sequentially to get to where you go. Okay. Okay, so, an example of an index, not an index to linked lists, but an example of an index is, we might have a table in our database, which has first names, a column of first names, a column of last names, and then a column of employee numbers. Okay, now suppose you wanted to search for somebody based on their last name. Well, this table is not in last name alphabetical order. So if you're looking for Grove, you would have to search this one and this one. That's not Grove, that's not Grove. You just linearly search them all. It would be nicer if maybe there was an index that would help you find the one you want. The employee numbers are also not in order, so if you're looking for a particular employee number, or let's say, for example, let's say there was some pattern to these employee numbers. Let's say the ones that start with E2, maybe the second number is the department you're in. Right? Let's say the first digit determines what department you're in. Suppose I wanted all the employees whose number starts with a 2, because I want to send them an email saying, you know, the department has a picnic tomorrow. But I don't want to tell all the other employees. So I want to go to my database and I want to pull out all the employees whose number starts with a 2. Well, the only way I can do that, since they're not in any kind of order, is I have to read every one.
Does this one start with a 2?
No.
Does this one?
Yes.
All right, save that one. This one's a no.
No, 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 no.
Yes,
save that one.
No, no, no.
Now I got them all. Is there some way we could do a query? So this would be, you're writing an SQL statement. You're saying, give us, you know, select star from this table where employee number starts with a 2. And it would have to check every one. And then it would give you the answer. So is there some way we could do that query faster? So suppose we had an index. So all an index is a data structure that helps us find stuff faster. Suppose we had an index. So here's our table. Now we have a second piece of storage that keeps all of the employees' numbers in order, keeps them in order, and then tells us it has a pointer, a reference to where that one is. What we can now do is, instead of going through the whole table, looking at every one of these, we could go to the index and say, I could do a binary search. I could look in the middle and say, does this one start with a 2? No. Okay, then I go to the halfway point, and then eventually I could get to the point where it starts here. So here's the first one. I go and I read that record, and I get that person's data, and then I just go to the next one. Here's the next one. I read that data, and then I go to the next one, and this one's not a 2, so I'm done. So instead of going through the whole table, I search my index to the start of it, and then I go through each one after the other, until I hit one that doesn't meet that criteria, and I'm done. So this could save me a lot of time in searching for things. So you can, in your database, you create your table. And then you can decide if it makes sense. You have to kind of use judgment. Should I create an index for the employee numbers? So what are the things you're considering if you decide to create an index for employee numbers? What's good about it, what's bad about it? What's good about it is, if you're going to do searches on this column, you can do the searches faster, right? What's bad about it? Bad about it is, every time you add a new person to the database, we would add a new person. We put in their first name, their last name, their employee number, and now this index is no good. It's not no good. It's got a problem with it. It doesn't have that new person. So we'd have to go back. Let's say the new person, their number goes right between this one and this one. Well, maybe an array is a bad choice, because now what we have to do is copy this guy over, this one over, this one over, this one over, this one over, to make room, put the new one in, and then have the new one point to the new employee. So the downside is, every time we add a person or delete a person, we have to change the index, because the index is telling us where everybody is. So every time we alter the table, we add a person, we delete a person, maybe we change their number. Every time we alter the table, we have to alter the index, which takes time. But the upside, the good side, is every time you go looking for something, you can find it much faster. So you have to kind of use your judgment. I don't even, like, I don't even know if it would make sense to have an index on first names. When do you need, you ever like say, I want all the employees whose name is Sunil. I want to send them an email. I mean, what, nobody really does that. So I don't know if putting an index on a first name makes any sense. If you do that, every time you add something or delete something, you now have a new index that has to be recalculated. That's going to slow you down. And if you don't do searches on it, then why bother? So you have to kind of use your head. There was one release of Oracle, maybe it was Oracle 8, where normally when you create tables, when you create columns in a table, by default, there's no index on the column. You have to specifically say, I would like an index on this column. And so, you know, you say the syntax for it. I didn't put it in this set of slides, I put it in the next set of slides. But there's a syntax where you say, I'd like to add an index on the employee ID field. I'd like to add an index on last names. You decide. There was one release where, by default, everything got an index unless you said, I don't want an index. And a lot of, you know, so a lot of programmers were like, I don't like that, because when they started using the database, every time they added a new record, all these indexes had to be recalculated. So they got rid of that. So you have to actually ask for it. And yeah, the thing you're taking into account is indexes make it slower for you to update and change the table, but helps you with searching. So the most common style of an index in databases is somehow you're searching for something, you visit a node, it's not usually a binary tree, there's usually a lot more data at each node, and this kind of gets the point across. Suppose you were looking for something that happened during a particular hour, on a particular day, on a particular year. You might want to have, so you have, your table has everything that happened in every hour since, you know, the beginning of time. If you want, looking for a particular hour, you might take the year, and the year node might have 12 children. So then you say, for this particular year, I want to go down this year. Now, at a particular year, I want to pick a particular month, so this one. Sorry, 12 months is what I meant. Right, so the year would have 12 children, one for each month. You would follow the path to that month, and then that month would have up to 31 days. And then you'd take one of the 31 children to go to the day you're on. From that day, you can go to hours. Let's say there's 0 through 23. You go through the hours. And then it would be a linked list, and you go through all those hours. If you wanted to say what is the next day after the day you're looking for, you could go along a linked list to the next day, and then that would have a bunch of hours too. But you could also have the hours linked together across the bottom. So what's very popular, it's strange, it usually doesn't come up in your analysis of algorithms class, to have a data structure that is a search tree, not a binary search tree, but a many, many children search tree. And it eventually takes you to the bottom of the tree where you find whatever it is you're looking for. And it could be hours, or it could be hours, or it could be days. But it's very popular in databases to make a linked list go across the bottom. Because in your algorithms class, you're usually looking for one thing. You go and you find it and you say, I found it. In databases, you're looking for a series of things that starts with this one. And once you find it, you then just want to go to the next one. Kind of like if you wanted to read a chapter in a book, you find where the first page is, and then once you start reading, you go next page, next page, next page, right? You don't go to the table of contents and say, where's chapter 4, page 1, then go there, then go back to the table of contents, where's chapter 4, page 2? You just go to page 1 and then do sequentially read that, all the ones after that. So it's very popular in databases to use a data structure that is an index. An index helps you find stuff, and sometimes it's in layers. And then when you eventually get to what you're looking for, chances are the things you're looking for after that are the ones right next to it. Usually, you're looking for a bunch of stuff that starts with one value, and then you just go to the ones next to it. So it's very popular to have an index which points to a linked list. And even the linked list, in this case, could have linked lists coming off of it. So if you wanted to know what happened between 11 p.m. and 2 a.m., you would, on a particular day, you go, you find the year, the month, the day, then go to the particular hour for that day, and you'd sequentially read through them. If it now goes into another day, you don't want to come to the top and go down the index again to find the next day and pick up the first hour. The 11, you know, it'd be like 11 p.m. and then midnight, and then 1 a.m. of the next day would be right next to it. So you could just keep reading through the length. Yeah, so this is a popular style of a data structure used for an index within a database class. So they call this, so it's important that the tree be balanced, so we don't take any really long paths to the bottom. So every time we update the tree, we're going to spend the time to balance the tree. That'll make our searches quicker. And then we're going to have a linked list across the bottom. So an index that takes you to a linked list is a very popular data structure to use. So we're going to it's going to be a balanced tree, a balanced search tree with a linked list across the bottom. So they usually call B trees, means balanced trees in your algorithms class. And then we threw in the notation of plus, a B plus tree, means it's a balanced tree that takes you down to a linked list. The linked list takes you to all the, everything.